Okay, in this video, I want to tell you guys how to use special functions to answer some of the famous non-elementary integrals. And if you want to do the following, then you will be able to solve a lot more integrals and you'll be happier too. So have a look here. These are the ones that have been proven that they have no elementary antiderivative, meaning that you cannot just use your usual technique and the usual functions to answer this. So this is what I will do. I will first tell you guys the answers to this right here with special functions, and then I'll tell you guys the definitions of the special functions. And I will base on Wikipedia and WolframAlpha for the definitions, right? So let's look at the first one. We have the integral of e to the negative x squared. That is a famous one. In fact, everything here is famous. This is my favorite though, because I like probability and statistics. Well, to answer this right here, in statistics, you can use what we call the error function. So you just write down ERF. This right here is the name of the function, and the input is x. However, because how the error function is defined, we actually have to multiply by a constant. And the constant right here is square root of pi over 2. I will explain why later. And let's just put on a plus c. This right here will be the answer for that, if you enter this on WolframAlpha, right? Now, for the second one, notice that here we have a positive x squared instead of the negative x squared. In this case, this right here is what we call the imaginary version of the error function, and the name is ERF. This is the name of the function, and the input is x. Again, you multiply by the constant, namely the square root of pi over 2, and we add a plus c, that's it. Continue. Next one, the integral of e to the x over x. Well, for the answer right here, we are just going to answer it as e I of x. Namely, the exponential integral function, and this right here is the name for that, and the input right here is x. You don't need any constant multiple. This right here is it, e I of x plus c. Number four, the integral of 1 over natural log of x. Yes, this is just li, namely the logarithmic integral function, and that's the name for it, and the input is x plus c. We don't need any constant multiple. Now, for this right here, I believe you use them a lot in physics, and you guys can also leave a comment down below. Let me know, where have you used this kind of integrals? Where have you encountered these integrals in your classes or in your work, in your studies? Number five, the integral of sine x over x. This right here, it's called the sine integral. So you just put on si of x plus c. That's it. No need for any constant multiple. And you can guess it, number six is just the cosine integral, and then put on plus c. That's all. Very, very cool, right? All right, number seven, number eight, they are the Fresnel integral. And let's look at the sine version first. In fact, there are two definitions. For the first one, I want to tell you is the easy version. You can answer this as just s of x plus c. Well, you can use this right here for the answer for that, depending on your definition. And Wikipedia used this as well, right? You can check that out. So this right here will be okay. However, if you use WolframAlpha, if you're in physics, you will actually have to answer this as the following. There's some kind of constant multiple being involved. What you do is, the name is still s, but the input is going to be square root of 2 over pi. Both of these are inside of the square root. And then multiply by x. And this x is outside of the square root, like that. And then in the front, we multiply by constant multiple square root of pi over 2, like this. Right? And again, I will show you guys the definition, but if you enter this on WolframAlpha, this is the answer that you actually get. So this is the blue one right here. And for number 8, you can guess it, it's just you replace the s with c. So for the first one, we'll just answer this as c of x plus c. Or, same thing here. We will answer this as square root of pi over 2, c of square root of 2 over pi, and then multiply by x. This x is again outside of the square root. That's it. Put a plus c, and we are done. Just like this. So hopefully you guys all like this video, and if you do, please give me a like and also subscribe. And as always, that's it. Okay, I know I haven't told you guys the definitions yet for the special functions, so I'm back. Anyway, for the first one, we have the error function. So we have ERF. And the input right here is x. And this right here is equal to, we have the integral going from 0 to x, and e to the negative t squared dt. Remember that this variable and this variable cannot be the same, and the t is just a dummy variable. Here is the deal. If we take x to past infinity, then the integral going from 0 to infinity of e to the negative t squared, that's half of the Gaussian integral. And the area under the curve is square root of pi over 2. And when we are doing probability or statistics, a lot of times we want the area under the curve to be just 1. So we want to just multiply by a constant to scale that down. This right here, again, when we go from 0 to infinity, it will give us square root of pi over 2. So let's go ahead and multiply by 2 over square root of pi, so that when we take x to be infinity, this will give us 1. And that's what we like in probabilities. All right, so that's ERF of x. Next, the imaginary version is the following. ERFI of x. It's just that we have a positive here instead of this negative. So this right here is 2 over square root of pi times the integral going from 0 to x. And we have e to the positive t squared dt. All right? And in fact, there's a really cool connection between this and that. And that is, this right here is equal to negative I. And this is the imaginary number I. And then we multiply by ERF. And this is the original version of the error function. And the input is ix. And as you can see, this is why that this is called the imaginary version of that. And to see why this is true, notice here we have positive t squared, but this is a negative t squared, right? Well, we can look at this as negative negative t squared. And then from the negative t squared, we can look at that as parentheses, I t, and then square. And then we do a substitution, let u equal to I t, and you can work that out. But this right here is it. Okay, continue. Next one, we have EI of x. Well, again, this is defined in terms of integral. However, on WolframAlpha, they defined it to be negative integral negative x to infinity, and then e to the negative t over t dt. I am really not sure why, because if we are willing to do a substitution, let u equal to negative t, you end up with a better form, in my opinion. You end up with the integral going from negative infinity to positive x right here, and then e to the u over u du, like this. And in my opinion, this is much easier. For example, if you want to differentiate this, you can simply put the x right here and right here, and of course, you get e to the x over x, and that's exactly what we want, isn't it? All right, so I think both are okay. They are equivalent, of course. And right here, I do have to tell you guys, this is only good if x is not equal to 0. Otherwise, we'll get a divergent integral. You get a negative infinity, I believe. All right, so that's a little restriction that we have to worry about. Now, next one, we have the little li of x. This right here is defined to be the integral going from 0 to x. And here we have 1 over ln t dt. And notice that we do have a lot of restriction right here. Because we're talking about natural log, we don't want to have negative input. Otherwise, we have to go to a complex world again. So we do have x being greater than 0. And in the meantime, x cannot be equal to 1. Otherwise, that will end up with a divergent result. So this is pretty much the idea, right? That's pretty much it. But again, we have a really nice connection between this and that. And the connection is, in fact, li of e to the x, this is equal to ei of x. And you can also do it like this. Ei of ln x is equal to li of x. Very, very cool. So they are just a really nice connection of each other. All right. Number 5, si of x, the sine integral. This right here is defined to be the integral going from 0 to x. And the input is just, the inside here is just sine t over t dt. Nothing too crazy. If you differentiate this, you just get sine of x over x. Or you can also say this is the sinc function, S-I-N-C. And then the input right here inside wise will be the t and integrate that. But yeah. And perhaps I'll also tell you guys a really cool fact on this integral. Namely, the integral going from 0 to infinity of sine t over t dt. This right here is pi over 2. Very, very nice. And perhaps I should also go back here and tell you the integral going from 0 to infinity of e to the negative t squared dt. This right here is square root of pi over 2. Huh, it's really weird, huh? We have a lot of pi and the 2, and then this one has a square root, this one does not. And what's really cool is that, in fact, you can actually have a constant multiple right here next to the t instead of the sine. Let me show you. When we have integral going from 0 to infinity of sine of a t, and of course a cannot be 0, and then over t dt, this will also give you pi over 2. It doesn't matter what a is, as long as it's not 0. Very, very nice. Right? So nice. You guys can try this out. Do some substitution and you'll see it. Okay, so next one we have ci of x. I think some of you guys may about to guess it. Isn't this just going to be the integral going from 0 to x? Well, the problem is that this function has a vertical asymptote when x is equal to 0. That's no good. But earlier, when we have sine x over x, when x is approaching 0, the limit of that is 1. So we didn't have any vertical asymptote. So it was OK to start with 0 to this. But for this one, we cannot go from 0 to that. This is how we define ci of x. Again, we have the integral. And we actually end up with going from x to infinity. And then we have the negative here. And the inside is, of course, cosine t over t dt, like that. OK? So that's pretty much it. Well, what if you really want to start with 0, though? Unfortunately, that's not ci of x anymore. That's called the sin of x. And this is not really the same as that anymore, neither. This right here is defined to be the integral going from 0 to x. And the inside is 1 minus cosine t over t dt, like this. So this is sin of x. Yeah, very cool, very special. And again, this right here, when t is approaching 0, we actually don't have a vertical asymptote. So that was legit. So we can start with 0 and up to x. So this is like another thing, right? Anyway, the truth is, if you differentiate ci of x, we will get cosine x over x. That's what we care about the most. All right, now, next one. Well, if you want to use the Wikipedia definition, namely the non-normalized version of the Fresnel integral, namely s of x, this right here is the easy version. This is just going to be the nice integral, in my opinion. Namely, integral going from 0 to x, and we have sine of t squared dt. And that's all. Done deal, right? However, if you are using WolframAlpha, you will actually end up with this. Because they define s of x this way. Let me put this down for you guys. The integral going from 0 to x, of course. Right? Nothing tricky yet. But for the inside, we have sine of pi over 2 t squared, like that, and then the dt. Well, why? Because it's actually similar to what we did with the ERF of x. So the idea is that we want to make sure the area under the whole curve to be 1. Well, take a look at the following. If we have the integral, and this time, let me write down this one for you guys. The integral going from negative infinity to positive infinity of sine of t squared dt. This right here is equal to square root with both pi over 2, right? Pi and the 2 right here. Inside. Notice, this right here, the pi over 2, they were inside of the square root. For this one, it's square root of pi only, and then the 2 is not inside of the square root. And then, here we have no square root at all, just pi over 2. So nice, isn't it? And when we have this, we get square root of pi over 2, But when we have the pi over 2 next to the t squared, I will put this down for you guys. The integral going from negative infinity to positive infinity of sine of pi over 2 t squared dt. This right here, when we have this multiple next to the t squared, in fact, we end up with just a nice number 1. Very, very nice, right? And in fact, right here, a has to be positive in order to get positive pi over 2. If it's negative, just take the negative outside, but, you know, yeah. So, yeah, very cool. And now, in the end, we have the c of x. It's pretty much just like this, but you change the sine to cosine. That's about all, and I'll do that for you guys. So, c of x. This right here is nicely equal to the integral going from 0 to x, and we have the cosine instead of the sine. So, that's pretty much it. And the cool part about this is that, very nice, okay? I will put this down in green, like why not? When we have the integral going from negative infinity to positive infinity, and if we have cosine of t squared, this right here will also give us square root of pi over 2. They have the same answer. And on the other hand, when we have the integral going from negative infinity to positive infinity of cosine of pi over 2 t squared dt, this is nicely equal to 1. Very nice. All right, so this is it. A lot of new functions today. Hopefully, you guys all enjoy this. And keep this in mind because I would like to do more videos with these special functions, integral battles for you guys.